Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua, Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, we come to you this morning and we just pray that you would have your way with us. We pray that you'd send your Holy Spirit, Lord, just like that breeze that you send here on this beach. We pray that you would refresh us. Give us this day our daily needs, Lord, and for each of us where we're broken, Lord, fix us. Lord, where we're riding high, Lord, we just pray that you would continue to encourage us. And Lord, we lift up those that aren't with us right now, and we just ask you to bless them. We pray for Joe and everyone that's out on outreach right now. We just pray that you would use them to bear mighty fruit. Mm-hmm. And Lord, we just pray that even now you would bear fruit on us. Lord, fill us with the fruits of the Spirit, all those things that we've been studying, Lord. And as we continue to learn more, Lord, we pray that you just wouldn't leave it empty here, but Lord, help us to apply it to our life and help us to apply it this coming day and this week. And we ask that now in Jesus' name we pray. Everyone said, Amen.
Amen. Well, bless the Lord, guys. This morning we're going to be looking at Galatians chapter 5 again. We're continuing the fruits of the Spirit. So if you haven't been with us, this is a sweet part of the scripture.
I'll be in the shade.
Hey, Aaron, your mic's still on. It's okay, but later we'll have fun. Gives the editing guys something to do. Poor Dylan. Hey, guys, if you didn't hear last week when the whales popped up, they actually got it and put it on the video of the sermon. So if you want to share with your friends that, you know, hey, I went to church on a beach in Hawaii and there really is whales, tell them to look at the one on goodness and kindness, the fruits of the Spirit that we covered last week. Those two fruits of the Spirit, by the way, you know, when people say, why are you so big about going over each fruit of the Spirit? Because these are the things that, you know, Paul was very clear. He said when he was teaching the people around him how to follow the Lord, there was a lot of guys. Anyone new at your faith that you've been a Christian, let's say, less than a couple years, less than 2 years, raise your hand if you just... Okay, for the ones that are just going starting out, Paul the Apostle was a really interesting character. He was one of those guys, he taught by example. And I like that kind of teacher. I hate the guys that are those do as I say but not as I do kind of guys. They don't fly with me. If you're going to say you're a Christian, then show me. You know, when being raised Catholic, there was a saying we learned from Mother Teresa that she... I went to a Catholic church called St. Teresa's, so we always got to hear the sayings. And one of the sayings was to share Jesus all the time and use words only when necessary. And I was like, huh? You know, when you're little, you, what? Share Jesus all the time, but use words only when necessary. In other words, how are you supposed to share Jesus? By your actions. You know, actions speak louder than words. And when people are looking at you, they're saying, how do I do that Christian thing? Well, Paul the Apostle, he was very clear. In one of his epistles, he said, you just be an imitator of me as I'm an imitator of who? Of Jesus. I'll imitate him and I'll show you. Now, that takes guts. I mean, think about this. If you had someone that was new to the faith and they came around and said, I don't really know how to do this. And you just say to them, oh, it's okay. Just copy me. I'll show you. How many are you willing to do that? 24/7. I mean, you don't get to say, I feel like sinning right now. You just stay over here. Don't copy this part. And then you can copy me later when I'm back to being right with the Lord. No. This is one of the best things for your faith, by the way, is Jesus said this as a command. But right before he departed this earth, he gave a thing at the end of the book of Matthew called the Great Commission. He said to go into all the world and make what? Disciples. A disciple is a follower of Jesus. And some people, to know how to follow him, you know, when you're just starting out, you need someone to help show you. And you guys, since, you know what, sometimes I feel weird because I look around and I think, I can tell this group, there's a bunch of Christians here already. I'm preaching to the choir. And it started to bug me because, you know, like, when you're telling Christians this stuff, I think, they already know, right? I mean, doesn't everyone read the book? We got the book. You just read. It says right here, do this, you know. And Paul would say, just imitate me like I'm imitating the Lord. Now, what was his goal? Was it that he always wanted people imitating him? No. It was that it was just to set the example, getting them going the direction toward the Lord, because he was showing the way. And when you have someone who shows you by example, here's how to do it, it helps you get the right focus and follow the Lord. You know, eventually Paul's like, good, you're doing good. Here, I'll just step out of the way. Keep going. You know, he's the kind of guy that just got people to follow the Lord. When it comes to the things of the Spirit, these fruits that we've been going over, love and peace and patience, kindness, gentleness. Well, these kind of things, they're complemented by one we're going to look at today called faithfulness. We're going to take a little zoom in look at faithfulness because it's one of the ones listed here. And there's a couple more, but I'm going to save them for next week because faithfulness is not one to be overlooked. Now, in every fruit of the Spirit, if you need a good example of that fruit of the Spirit, who should we look to for our example? Jesus. Just look to the Lord. Like when we looked at kindness, can anybody think of a story where Jesus was kind to some folks? Or I got one. How about the woman who they drug before him and they said, it was the religious leaders. We caught this woman in the very act of adultery. What say ye? You know, what should we do? The law says we should what? Stone her to death. Should we get some rocks and do you remember what Jesus did? It says he stooped down in the sand and he just began to write. And he looked up, he said, he who is without sin, let him cast the first stone in. Remember? And he began. Now, we don't know what he wrote, but I know what happened next because the Bible tells us. It says, beginning with the oldest down to the youngest, one at a time, they began to leave. I'm thinking he's like this Rabbi Schneerson, mean to his wife. You know, and then Schneerson's going, excuse me, I got to go now, drops his rocks, and he runs off. And then he goes to the next, right? And I can just see Jesus doing it. Next, he looks up, puts his name down, and starts writing down his sins. And the guy's like, I think I need to go too now. And I can just see Jesus wipe that away. Let's go to the next guy. Till what happened at the end of that story? Who was left? Just Jesus and the woman. And Jesus looked at her. And he said, wait right here. I'm going to get some rocks. I'll stone you. Right? No, that's not what he did. He said, woman, where are your accusers? And she said, there is none left but thee, Lord. There's only you left to accuse me of my sin. And what did Jesus say? He says, your sins are what? Forgiven. Go and someone just said it, go and sin no more. He showed kindness. You know, kindness is an expression, and mercy. He could have actually judged her. You know, we have in the Bible a word in the newer English translations that say loving kindness. If you study the old King James, you know the word was interchanged with the word mercy. You know, God is so merciful. We sing the song, his mercy is new every what? Morning. Every morning. And great is his what? Faithfulness. Now, interesting to me that when we look at Galatians 5:22, on the heels of goodness and kindness, or mercy, comes this next fruit that Paul mentions, faithfulness. Look with me at verse 22. If you haven't already highlighted, I recommend you highlight verse 22 and 23 because I'll just read it to you so you can see these fruits all together in a bunch. And then we'll zoom in on the one faithfulness this morning. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is what? There's no law. You know, when somebody walks with these things, do you have to tell them not to be mean? Or you got to make up some rule, don't do this. If they will keep the spirit of God's law because they have these fruits in their life. They come from the Lord. By the way, we only get these fruits by abiding in Jesus. Jesus said, if you abide in me, I'll abide in you. and you'll bear much fruit. This is the fruit we're to bear. This is the fruit that is really good fruit. But the one we're on today, faithfulness. You know, I went to the kids last night on Friday night with the youth group. Kids, faithful, you know, when you break it down from Greek, it's really, like just like Italian, we have things that we say in Italian that it's actually in a different order than they put it in English in a sentence. We put like the noun and the verb in a different place in the sentence. My kids think I talk funny sometimes. I'm just translating straight across the way my brain thinks it in Italian. And so the sentence comes up jumbled. And then they laugh at me. You know you said that backwards, Dad. I said, do you know what I meant? And they're like, yeah. Then hear what I meant, not what I said. I mean, that's how to cover that in grace when you have to deal with people that speak different languages. Don't worry about every little nitpicking thing. Do you understand what they're trying to say? If they're saying, pass the salt or salt pass to me, it's the same thing as, you know, get the salt over here. Come on. I mean, if you know what they meant, that's the whole idea of communication, is to convey an idea. Well, what is faithful? From the Greek, it's full of what? Faith. Hopeful. What's that? Full of hope. Okay? And I started going to the kids, what's other words with full? You know, because I like trying to think. Grateful. Beautiful. Then they started coming up with the bad words. Harmful, hurtful, spiteful. I said, they know a lot of words with full. There is a lot of different words that are, you know, end with that, what's it called, suffix? The thing on the end, suffix? The suffix, you know, there's youthful, peaceful, fearful, wonderful, right? Beautiful, resentful, awful. The kids gave me all these words. Mindful. I was like trying to figure out, full of mind. Now it means you're supposed to be paying attention if you're mindful, right? Your mind is engaged. These things, I mean, you're full of these things. This particular fruit, faithful, indicates that you are a person that is full of faith. Now, how do we get faith? The Bible says in Hebrews, faith cometh by what?
Hearing.
And hearing by the word of the Lord. When the Lord speaks, and by the way, does the Lord speak to each person? Do we need, I know that this is going to make some pastors mad if I say this, but do we need the church to get the gospel to somebody? I mean, it's a mandatory thing that God is limited. Without the church, he's going to fail, right? Wrong. It never stopped him before. In fact, if you want to put it on the shoulders of people to get the gospel done, good luck. You blew it right out the gate, man. The reality is our God is the God who has orchestrated and authored, it says, our salvation in Christ Jesus. Before the foundation of the world, the scripture declares, Christ was seen as a lamb that was what? Slain. Before this all came about, God already looked ahead and said, there's going to be some trouble. They need help. Sending in who? My only begotten son. I'm going to send him. And he's going to pay. And he will become the author and the finisher, the perfecter, that's right, of their faith. What a beautiful thing Jesus does for us. So we want to put that message. Some people don't know this. But how will they know it? The Bible says, unless there be a preacher. Unless somebody declares it. When they hear it, then, well, that word comes to their ear, and then they keep hearing about him. And you know, it's interesting, when someone is coming to learn about the Lord, you listen to their testimony later. They're like, everywhere I went, there was somebody talking about God. It was like, I don't know. I went to the grocery store. I was standing in line. I went to put some gas in my car at the little, you know, market, and I'm standing there, and the guy next to me at the pump is talking to his friend about Jesus, and Jesus everywhere, you know. Why do you... Who orchestrates all those conversations for that person? God does, right? His Spirit. In fact, the Bible teaches us that no man comes to the Father except that the Spirit of God draws them. And I love to hear the testimonies when God is drawing someone. It's like they can't run. Well, they can run, but they can't hide. Because no matter where they go, the Lord just keeps sending people in their path to talk to them about Jesus. And that's how faith comes about. It's this great thing. Now, we get a privilege to participate in that thing that God is doing when we just yield ourselves to Him. But this fruit of the Spirit, this full of faith fruit, you know, I want to show you something, and this helped me so much as a young believer. And maybe some of you older ones, if you just take notes on this so that you can pass it on for me, because I just got done teaching the kids this Proverbs chapter 3, where we were looking at, everyone knows the part about trust in the Lord with all your what? Heart, lean not to your own understanding, all your ways acknowledge Him, He will make your paths what? Straight. But I had the young men there, and I said, listen, guys, last night we had an interesting college and career group. It was all young men. None of the gals came. I thought, well, good. When you have a – is there any verses to just young men in the Bible? I thought, oh, okay. They were asking me, is there any verse about how to have a long, blessed life? Is there a verse about that? I said, yeah. And I thought, this is perfect. Lord, you're setting me up. I mean, this is like too easy. Turn to Proverbs. Let me just share this with you because I didn't get to record it, and I want it recorded for some of the kids who weren't there. So this is my chance. By the way, this YouTube thing is great because the kids watch YouTube more than they watch TV now. You know, I mean, it's like they tune in to see stuff. Turn to Proverbs 3. Now, those of you who already have your Bible highlighted with the trust in the Lord verse, great. But there's a verse before that verse. In fact, this whole proverb starts off with a father speaking to who? Son. Oh, hey, son, I got something to teach you. I thought, I got all boys here. Let's go for this. Listen to this. My son, he says, verse 1, do not forget my teaching. But let your heart keep my commandments. He says, for length of days and years of life they will and peace they will add to you. I couldn't believe they asked me, is there anything about if we do right, is there any verse that says it'll make us have a better life, a longer life, is there really a benefit to serving God? Well, you answer me. What do you think? My son, don't forget my teaching. Keep my commandments. Where? In your heart. Why? Because they give you length of days, the years of life, and peace added to you. Does that make for quality life right there? Now listen to the next verse. This one is I'm so set up for this. It's too easy. Verse 3. He says, do not let kindness and truth leave your what? Leave you. Bind them, he says, around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart so that you will find favor and good repute in the sight of God and of man. Now, if you would take, and I explained to them when I was in high school, I went out to Lompoc, California. My family was in the military. So military, I had my grandfather on my mom's side was one of the uppity generals at the Air Force base. So I taught everybody, it was so polite, because when you go in with one of the head generals and you're just a little grandson tagging along, and everyone salutes your grandfather. You know, they just stop whatever they're doing, salute him, you know, right away. And I'm like, not the hand, this hand, sorry. And they salute him, and you're just like, wow, he's important. You know, this is fun. And you go on the base, and everything is real pretty much strict. I was drilled, you know, be quiet, stand attention, be really polite, you know. Okay, stand there. This is really interesting. They got these rules, you know. But I went there, and my grandfather, he was very much on work. It doesn't hurt a man to work. Hardly working is what kills a man, he says. Not work. Hard work won't kill a man. Hardly working will. Okay. So, young man, what do I do? He's like, you need to, we're enrolling you in the lifeguard program. You're gonna learn to do lifeguard stuff. Okay. You know, and it's part of, you know, I'll learn to do lifeguarding. That sounds fun. And one of the guys I met, he gave me this puka shell necklace. He was from Hawaii. Now, when you're on the mainland and you're not, I had never been here. It was like a big deal. I had a puka shell necklace that was hand-picked shells from the beach. They were all different, you know, than just, he had strung his own thing. And he said, you know, at the end of our lifeguarding, I want you to have this necklace. This is mine. I never take this off. This has real special meaning to me. And so he gave it to me. I said, I'm all right, man. I ain't taking it off. It's mine, you know. I'm going to wear this thing forever. Guys would say, can I see it? No. Well, yeah, you can see from there. That's it. I'm not taking this thing off. This is my necklace from my friend who gave it to me, who was from Hawaii. And I wore that thing, you know, proudly all through high school. So I wore it out is what happened. And, you know, the string broke inside and the little shells popped and went everywhere. And tried to gather them up, but I must have missed a few somewhere and couldn't make the full length. But I held on those shells for years. I was like, but I remember how intently I would wear that thing. Like, I'm not taking this off. And when I looked at this verse and I was telling the young men, this father says to his son, son, I want you to put something around your neck. I want you to put this there and not take it off. It brought me back to that day of that shell necklace. I thought, yeah, but these shells they're not little white round donuts, you know, with a hole in them. These are kindness and truth. He said, bind them around, you know, put them on like a necklace. Now, if a young man keeps kindness and truth with him all the days, puts it around his neck, doesn't let it leave him, has it in his heart, how is this going to impact his life? How will he do in his courtship days? I tried to explain this to the guys. Guys, you don't want to be lying to your honey. Because as soon as she finds out you lied, it's over. I mean, she won't trust you, right? How do you build a relationship with broken trust? I mean, a healthy, long, lifelong. You don't. You build it on truth and kindness, and you keep these things with you all the days of your life. This is what the father is trying to tell his son. Keep this stuff with you. Don't let it go from you. Bind them, and you'll find favor and good repute. That means a good reputation with God and with man. And then, he says, see, everyone skips right past these verses to get to the trust in the Lord with all your heart verse. But before you trust in the Lord with all your heart, he says, put kindness and truth around your neck. Don't lie. Now, I know you think, well, that's, you have to preach that at church, Pastor? Yeah. I mean, on Tuesday night, we're doing the book of Ephesians. I find it very ironic that Paul has to write to the church at Ephesus, and he tells them, speak the truth. Ephesians 4:29, he says, let no unwholesome word come out of your mouth. Don't have any garbage coming out of this thing. He said, only good words they bring edification. They build up the people who hear your words. And then he had to throw in and speak the truth to one another and don't lie. And also I realized, yeah, Paul was writing to the church at Ephesus, right? So was he preaching to the non-believers this message? How about this message right here in Galatians? When he wrote to the it's a church, right? The churches of the region of Galatia. He's writing to Christians. He's preaching to the choir. Hey, choir, you all need to have goodness and kindness. And this fruit he saves to near the end. There's two more after this, but this one, faithfulness. You need to be full of faith. But has any of you ever had what I call a bad faith day? You know, your faith meter's like going down to the red zone, not looking good. I mean, Lord, how about that man in the Bible who who had his son that was afflicted and he brought him to Jesus. And if you can do it, Lord, Jesus, what? If I can? Like, well, he said, well, he said, anything's possible to him who believes, Jesus said. But he said, I believe, but help my what? My unbelief. Sometimes you just have a bad faith day. Lord, anyone, now this is only to you older Christians. Young Christians, don't raise your hand. Everyone, a Christian over 5 years, ever had a bad faith day, raise your hand. Look around. Just so you know, just one. Aaron goes, just one, just once.
Let me make it two.
Two. It's one of the things that I have to show you this verse, okay, because this is really important. This is also from a father to a son wisdom in the scripture, but it's not an earthly father to his earthly son. It's a spiritual father to his spiritual son. It's words that Paul would write to Timothy. When he would write to Timothy in 2 Timothy, the last letter he's going to write, Paul actually knows he's going to die pretty soon. He was in prison. He wrote off to Timothy and he said, Timothy, and this is 2 Timothy. Go to 2 Timothy chapter 2, if you would. He says to him, son, therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. He says, and the things which you heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, he said, entrust these things to faithful men who will be able to teach also to others. Okay, so Paul calls Timothy his son in the faith. Wasn't physically the son of Paul the apostle, but he was spiritually. And he says to him, son, I want you to be strong in what? Not muscles. No. You said it. In grace. Be strong in grace. And you've heard, he said, the things what I've taught you. But these things what I taught you, he said, I want you to take and not just hog them to yourself. This is something about our Christian experience. You are not meant to hold on to all the sweet things that you learn about the Lord and, like, you know, like chipmunk them away. It's like, I got my own little pile of nuts that I'm not sharing. You know, this is my own special thing. No, man. Paul told Timothy, all the things you heard me teach, I want you to take and pay it forward. Pass it on to others. And not only to pass on to others, he said specifically, pass on to others who will what? Pass on to even others. Don't hog your Christianity. You're going to take this grace, what we have received, and share it with those who will share it with those who will share. I mean, Paul's given him some real important parting words. But this is a part that has been a verse that has helped me through those bad faith days. I want to show you this one because sometimes it might happen. I mean, you saw the evidence of the hands that went up. It will most likely happen to every Christian. But if you can just go away this day with this one verse I'm going to show you from what Paul says to him, this can help you through the days when you struggle with your faith. When your faith is not faithful, it's more like faith less, you know, not full of faith, less faith, you know. When you're having a bad faith day, let me show you what he says to Timothy. He goes on, he tells him about being a soldier for the Lord, hanging in there, suffer hardship. Don't get tangled up with the world and the affairs of this world. Just, you know, consider what we're called to do. We're part of the Lord's army. And then he goes and he says in verse 8, remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, descendant of David, according to my gospel, he says, for which I suffer hardship, even to the imprisonment as a criminal. Paul was locked up. But listen to what he says next. But as to the word of God, was it imprisoned? He said, no. In fact, he wrote in another epistle, because of him being locked up, he said, the whole Praetorian Guard had come to faith. Did you guys know that they thought Paul the Apostle was, when he was called Saul, was such a bad guy? He had had his conversion, and they were like, this guy's upsetting the world with this teaching. He's a bad criminal. They locked him up and they made a Roman soldier stay shackled to him for 8 hours shifts. They were shackled to this guy. And Paul says, you guys think that they imprisoned me and it would stop the gospel? No way, man. The gospel has, it can't be imprisoned. In fact, the gospel spread even, I bet it was. Can you imagine being shackled to Paul for 8 hours? You think you're guarding him, he's going, I got you. Do you know about Jesus? We got time to talk. The whole Praetorian Guard winds up getting saved during the years Paul's in prison. Now, I wonder at first if they're going, oh, no, not the religious nut. I don't want to be chained to him. And then if it changed as they got saved, they're like, let me do it. I want to go in and talk. I got some more Bible questions. Can you just see? God has a great sense of humor. Paul says, even though I'm in prison, the gospel is not. For this reason, he said, I endure all things, verse 10, 2 Timothy 2:10, for the sake of those that are chosen, so that they also might obtain salvation, which is in Christ Jesus. And with it, they might obtain what? Eternal glory. Man, he wants them to have some good stuff. And he says, now it's a trustworthy statement, verse 11 says, for if we die with him, we'll also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, what will he do? He'll deny us. And if we are faithless, I don't know if you have ever noticed this verse. It's right here. If we are faithless, what does it say? He remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. One of the things that this verse right here, 2 Timothy 2:13, has carried me through some of the hardest times of my Christian faith. When I feel faithless, God always reminds me of this verse. He says, if you're faithless, like Lord's going, does that change me? Does that change the Lord? If we don't believe, all of a sudden God goes, well, oh, I guess I'm not here. You don't believe in me. Poof, I disappear. No. Remember the Jews, how stiff-necked they were when Paul wrote to that epistle to the church at Rome. In Romans chapter 3, he said that the Jews, they had all these benefits of God choosing them as the elect. And yet, he says, what then, verse 3, Romans 3:3, what then, if some of them did not believe, were there Jews that didn't believe? Yeah. Paul asks this question, then does their unbelief nullify the faithfulness of God? He actually asks it in a rhetorical form. If they don't believe, will this nullify the faithfulness of God? Will it? He says, come on. If we don't believe, does that make God poof disappear? If you say to me, well, I don't believe in God, so therefore he does not exist. I can't see him. I can't feel him. I'm a person who has to see and feel everything and know. Otherwise, I don't believe it. I'm like, well, okay, yeah, like Thomas. I had a question for you. How many of you have seen gravity lately? I never seen it. Does it have any power over your life? Oh, that's the effects of it, right? We pick up something, let go, boom. Someone says, I don't believe in stuff I can't see. It has no power over me. I said, come here. I'm going to go up to a high building with you. I'm going to push you off. I'm going to show you how things that you can't see have power over you. Whether you believe, you can tell me I don't believe in it. I'll say, take the first step, please. I'm not stepping because I don't have to see to know that there are things what are there that just because I can't see them doesn't nullify the truth that thing exists. For you to say, I don't believe in God, that doesn't change God being there. He's still there. And to the Jews, there were Jews that didn't believe. Did it change God's faithfulness? No. And this is the truth I want you to walk away with today. That no matter, even if you have a bad day and you don't believe that day, you're not faithful. Will he remain? Even though you be faithless, is how Paul put it, he remains faithful. And one of the best things I know for my faith is to remember I serve a God who is always consistent. He is always there for me. Doesn't matter what I'm going through. Worst thing ever. Yeah, I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. You guys know this one. I'll fear no evil, for thou art what? On vacation. Poof, you're gone, right? No. You're there. Now, do we see him there? Do we feel him? Do we touch? Listen, I'm here to tell you, the Lord is everywhere. There's no place you can go. Paul said, there's nowhere to escape the love of God. No height, no depth, no, you can't ascend to any super high place. You can't descend to Sheol. God's love is real. And his faithfulness is steadfast. Whether we stay steadfast or not, he always does. And it's important for us to know that for our faith. Maybe we're having a bad day. Maybe we're feeling a little, Lord, my faith is weak. We got to be like that man. Lord, help my faith. Cry out. Will God help your faith if you ask him? Yes. And I want to encourage you. Don't, you know, these fruits of the Spirit, as we go over them in detail, each one, sometimes some of the people will go, Pastor, you were talking about that patience when I really stink in that area. You know, I don't think God's even with me. I don't have any patience. Or maybe they struggle with kindness or peace. That's a fruit. You know, some Christians really struggle. They don't have peace. If you don't have these fruits in fullness, what do you have to do to get them? Abide in who? Jesus. Just stay put with Jesus. He'll grow them in you. He will reveal things about him, and those things that he shows you, they'll help you to grow. You will go from being weak in one area to filled in that area as you grow in the Lord. These fruits, I know, I have seen him take. Well, he took me. I mean, when people say, you're so positive that he can help me, I'm like, you don't know how I was. If he can take this messed up pile of person and fix him. You know, some people actually said, wow, you're really nice. I'm like, whoo, there is a God. You didn't know me before. And it's a God's grace my wife even courted me, you know. But she courted me through all the refining, you know. I was a little rough around the edges. Well, maybe a lot rough. But anyway, God works. And this is the beauty of serving the Lord. You want to prove that there's a living God? What did Paul write in Romans? Be therefore transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you can do what? That you can prove the good and acceptable will of God. What did Peter say the will of God is? It's God's will that none should what? Perish. You want to prove that God doesn't want anyone to perish? You need to let God transform you. Maybe you don't have a lot of patience. Maybe you're not kind. Maybe you struggle in being good. Let God grow those things in you, and your friends will say to you, wow, I remember you when you used to not be like that. There must be a God. I mean, if Izzy could change, there's got to be a God. It's a nice thing to be complimented when, in that way, when people see that there's growth in your life. I want to encourage you, let God grow these fruits in your life. Now today, we're going to end with communion. It's because of Sharon. She missed a couple weeks ago. She's like, I know, but what about me? And my wife was gone too on the mainland, so they say, can we do it again? Now, we can do communion as often as we will, it says. As long as we do it in remembrance of who? Of Jesus. We get to. Would you guys pass out the elements for communion? And while they do that, I want you guys to sing with me. We're going to sing together, Create in Me a Clean Heart. What David said to the Lord after he had sinned with Bathsheba. He said, Lord, I need you to fix me up. And communion is a great thing to do together. As long as, you know, we're all invited to take of communion. As long as you do it, it says, with the understanding that you have to judge one person, not me. You don't judge me, no. Not your spouse. Who are we supposed to judge? Who are we supposed to examine? Ourselves. Look at yourself and say, Lord, is there anything in me today that you want to bring to my attention that needs work? And if you'll do that with me, we'll partake of communion together. And it says, as often as we do this, we're proclaiming who died. Jesus died. And is that a good thing to proclaim to a world that might not know? You know, why did Christ die? For us. For our sins to be forgiven. So we're going to proclaim Christ's death until he comes. And I love to be able to take communion with you because it's just a really good thing for my spirit. It gives me a spiritual boost, so to speak, to make me grow and be enriched in my walk with the Lord. But could I have the worship team come up here and sing with me? I want to sing with, I don't want to do this all by myself up here, but we'll get the rest of the gang up here. And if you need the words, this is from Psalm 51, verse 10 through 12. But it's in the song sheet, too. It's number 11. We'll sing, Create in Me a Clean Heart, O God.
Create in me a clean heart, O God. And renew a right spirit within me.
Do that again.
Create in me a
restore Lord, that's our prayer here together today, that you would renew each person. Lord, if there be any area where we're falling short, where we're weak and faithless, Lord, we pray that you would grow us into people full of faith in you. As we partake of communion together in this place, the scripture declares in Matthew 26:26 that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, while he was at the supper table with his disciples, it says he took bread at that last Passover and he broke it. He said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." I'd like you to take the matzah cracker that you have and just break it as a remembrance of the bread of life, what came down from heaven. John's gospel tells us it came down to give us life eternal. Lord Jesus, we celebrate the gift of you being broken on our behalf, that great sacrifice you would give of yourself for us. And we take of this bread now, Lord, not lightly, but as a proclamation that you would come and die for our sins. And we proclaim your death until you return, Lord. We're so grateful that you would die on our behalf. And we say thanks be to you, Lord Jesus. Let's partake together. After he took the bread, he lifted the cup. He said, "This is a cup of a new covenant in my blood. This is done for the remission of your sins." Remission is a fancy Bible word that means the complete removal. Anybody want your sins removed? To you, Lord Jesus, we ask you would wash away all our sins. We confess to you we're but sinners, and we need your grace. So pour it out into each of us, Lord, as we partake of this in remembrance of the blood, what you spilt, your blood, to wash away our sins. We ask you, wash us now clean, make us white as snow, as Isaiah the prophet declared, though our sin be as scarlet. Let's take together to you, Lord Jesus. Now in the scripture, that verse I was just mentioning is found in Isaiah chapter 1. Praise the Lord, that's right. If you ask the Lord to forgive you, will he forgive you?
Yep, every time.
The Bible says, though your sin be as scarlet, he'll make you white as what? As snow. Thank God we don't have that for an example to show you today, but there's plenty of you from back east, you know what it looks like. White as snow. White as snow, though my sins were as scarlet.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.